Hi, welcome everyone. We've had a wonderful chat on data in iGaming and the amount of data that we process in iGaming. I think that panel was fantastic. In terms of, and specifically I pointed that out, because from a perspective of a third-party supplier, in terms of speed of data access, in terms of speed of ability to read and probably educate your customers what is necessary, and then react and allow them to react on the customer behavior, I'd really like your take on what you have seen are good practices in terms of data architecture, of how data is served, stored, and your understanding on the customer's domain knowledge and what it is they should be storing, right?
So first of all, it's really interesting that you speak about the customer journey. I think gone are the days when we could think of the customer journey as being purely linear and single channel. I think we have multi-point journeys in omni-channel environments. And I think it's critical for us vendors to map to this particular customer journey the specific business pain points which we see in the industry and how a technology can specifically serve against those pain points. Now, your question specifically asked about best practices in data architecture. Ibo recently conducted a survey amongst the iGaming industry in Southern Europe. And what we found is that 60% of operators have some type of front-end engagement tools, and around 80% of them have a CRM tool. But the data from these two tool sets is in no way integrated. So not only do you have a disruption in the data management across these different tool sets, but you have the inability to consolidate meaning, right, from this data. And I think this is the key point which we'd need to make here around best practice, is that it's one thing to collect data, but it requires an entirely different skill set to make that data actionable. Absolutely. And that is, I think, what we need to do today. And in conversational AI, what that means for us is that on an engagement level, we're not simply understanding the content of that which is being said at an engagement front, but also the context of that Absolutely. Information. And making that operational is really the key to success in the general approach towards the architecture of the solution.
When we are talking about real time, we are talking about two things in particular. If we are aggregating historic data, then technologically speaking, and please correct me if I'm wrong, going back a transaction trail, especially aggregated transaction trail across all the customers you have on your platform, going back 6 months, I mean, that's a call that's going to come back in, you know, let's continue this conversation tomorrow, right? Mm-hmm. So the necessity for correct aggregation paired with the event-driven design. So today we are event-driven. We need to react in real time. So where do you draw that balance? Where do you draw that separation? And how do you merge the two, right?
I think we need to be thinking about moving from an event-driven type of strategy, which is reactive in nature, to an event-triggered, which is more predictive in nature. I think the environment which we're building today is one which is increasingly predictive, Igor. And I'd say that even when we have a defined scope and we're using very simple linear regression, our predictive abilities are already significantly accurate, especially in areas where you have very linear processes. So I think you are correct in explaining that the iGaming industry is so particular and so complex with so many layers. However, a lot of the processes which occur in gaming are linear in nature, which create the right model, the right opportunity for us to predict outcomes. But I think another interesting point for us to explore is this idea that generally a lot of the AI models that we look at create some form of classified data, right, from existing data silos. And we use that then to create the predictive model. I think we are going to be moving very rapidly into an environment whereby we need to start data enrichment exercises from blending in data from external third-party sources to be able to better inform us of the outcomes of our models. And if you allow me, Igor, I'll give an example which is pertinent to these, you know, COVID days that we are going through. So we're a London-based organization, and we're looking very closely at how the British government was looking at reopening the economy. Mm-hmm. And they created a predictive model to try and study the impact that weather conditions, mm-hmm. external third-party data source, right? Weather conditions would have on the reopening of pubs in central London and the impact on the tax computation. Because any pub owner is going to say, is it worth me opening? Am I going to make enough money based on the taxes and the rent which I need to pay? And the weather is a key determinant. So this is just one very simple example, which shows that the models of data within gaming are linear, but could become enriched through the infusion of third-party data, which will allow us to be much better at RG requirements or particular predictions which help the growth of the operator's business.
My actual question is, where does AI become an I? Yeah? Where does it become an intelligence rather than a simple rule engine? Yeah?
Let me unpack the I in AI, right? I'll start off by saying that I think machines today and the capabilities we have are becoming less artificial and far more intelligent, right? So in other words, the systems we build rely less on bottom-up big data and more on top-down reasoning. It closely resembles the way we humans approach problem-solving and tasks. So the usefulness of AI is growing because it doesn't remain related to the very narrow domain, but becomes more involved in decision support, if you wish. And I think the eye of AI is particularly relevant over here because we're seeing our tools become suitable in scenarios in the gaming industry, which would have been totally unimaginable just a few months ago. Yes, I agree that the starting pool needs to be historical data, but it doesn't need to be enormous. With this reversion of the pyramid, if you wish, from bottom-up to top-down reasoning, our AI tools can give value even if you have limited data sets to feed it. I think a perfect example of this is what Google have been doing in their whole, you know, AlphaGo Zero and AlphaZero models, whereby what used to take them months for training is done in a few hours, simply based on the different approach which we have to the learning process. So we should, in my view, not overemphasize the necessity of hardware constraints or data constraints, because the innovation trajectory which we are on is seeing far more huge capabilities that we have in intelligence provision. And we've had some excellent results with gaming organizations which had very little historical data for us to go by. Yes, of course, it's an advantage when you have a vendor which has existing data sets from other operators, from other industries, which become applicable, let's say language models or language understanding models. But it still means that our capabilities are allowing us to fulfill far more business needs than a few months ago without large data sets. And that is where the eye of AI becomes intelligent.
That's a fantastic answer. That's something I was looking for.